the source of chemistry. Our exploration so far tells us that the vast majority of the mass of the atom is concentrated in the nucleus. The much lighter electrons buzz around the nucleus, constrained to stay in the neighborhood by the electromagnetic attraction between the negative charge that they carry and the positive charge charged nucleus. This is a reminiscent of the mini solar system. With a lighter planet in orbit around a more massive star in the center. However, we already know that electrons are not classical particles. This is another point at which their quantum mechanical nature makes a huge difference. In this case, it indicates the way atoms bind and react to form molecules and compounds, and explains the structure of Mendeleev's periodic table itself. Sure. The reactivity of the different elements depends upon how tightly bound to the nucleus are the electrons they contain. As we tour atom land and visit the atom of the various different elements, we find they contain the different numbers of electrons. We find they contain different number of electrons, enough to balance the positive charge of the different nuclei. But we also find that these electrons cannot have any old orbitary energy. They have a specific set of the binding energies characteristic to the atom of each element. These characteristic energies are what determines the ability of the atom to form molecules and other associations with the neighboring atoms. They are responsible for the whole of chemistry, sure, and everything that follows from it. Like any curious explorer, we need to understand how this all works, what fixes these energies. An electron of their particular energy has a particular wavelength associated with it, as we saw on our previous voyage. When traveling around freely, crossing the ocean of our map, the electron can have any wavelength, and therefore, whatever energy, no restrictions. Oh. But when they are confined within atom land, bounds close to an atomic nuclei, this is no longer true. The fact that only certain energy are allowed it implies that only certain very particular wavelengths are allowed. This fixed wavelength is where we can start to understand what is going on with the electrons. There are other situations where only a few special wavelengths are allowed. One example is the harmonics on the guitar strings. Luckily, we have a guitarist on our boat who will help illustrate this. In the clearing in one of the forests of the atom land, we make camp, build a fire, and sit ourselves around it to hear what she has to say. As dusk draws in, and the tiny electrons buzz around the tree tops above us. Each note that a musical instrument makes correspond with the particular wavelengths of the sound. Sure. Each note that a musical instrument makes correspond with a particular wavelength of the sound. A guitar strings of a certain length will make a particular note, determined by the fact that an exact number of the half wavelengths corresponding to that note have to fit into the space allowed on the string. The ends of the guitar string at the bridge and the nut, or at the fret when the guitarist holds the string down, are fixed. So the ends of the guitar string at the bridge and the nuts are fixed. They can't vibrate like the rest of the strings. So a wave on the string must have the fixed points at each end, point at which the amplitude of the oscillation is zero. This has the consequences that not all wavelengths work. a wavelength as long as the string is okay, it would have fixed points at each end and another fixed point in the middle with a peak and a trough a quarter and three quarter of the way long, swapping sides as the wave bounces back and forth. A wavelength twice the length of the string also works, with the middle of the string oscillating up and down. This would actually be the bass harmonic of the string, and the open note a guitar plays. The important point is that any wavelength that doesn't allow stationary points at each end of the string is forbidden. So any wavelength that doesn't allow stationary points at each end of the string is forbidden. That is what happened with the electrons too, when they are confined close to an atomic nucleus. The limits of the electron's distance from the nucleus are like the bridge and nut of the guitar. They define the fixed point which the electron cannot go beyond and where the wave associated with the electron is stationary. This means only a certain wavelengths are allowed, and that in turn means that only a certain energy are possible, and that in turn explains the peculiar structure in which the electrons are bound to the nucleus of the atom we have encountered. The equation which describes these waves is the Schrödinger equation, less famous than his cat, but much more useful. Sure, yeah. There is a final piece of the information we need to make sense of the emerging internal arrangement of the atom land. There is a definite list of the allowed energy levels for an electron bound inside the atom. The harmonics of their orbits around the massive central nucleus. But one might expect that the most stable situation for an atom is that all the electrons sink to the lowest energy level. All of them play the bass tone. That is not what we see. Okay. Each energy level allows only two electrons to occupy it, and is then full. The no vacancies signs go up for any further electrons, which will then have to make do with the next lowest energy level. This unfriendly behavior is the exclusion principle discovered by the Wolfgang Pauli, one of the first explorers of our landscape, who will meet again before too long. Okay, so back to the topic. Okay, so which will then have to make do with the next lowest energy level, which can then only take two of them, pushing the rest still higher, and so on. An atom in its lowest energy state has all its electrons in the lowest available levels, with all the higher levels empty. So back to the silicon, the 14 electrons are in the 7 lowest energy levels, 2 of them in each. Sodium has 11 electrons, they will fill the lowest 5 energy levels, leaving the 6-1 half filled, 1 electron and 1 vacancy. In this way, the atoms build up the shells of the electron. With an energy level inside the shell filled and those outside empty, with sometimes in the vacancy on the edge. This intricate the structure of the electrons and energy levels determines the size of the atom and its propensity to react and form molecules. There are lots of questions that can be asked here. For example, why 2 electrons per energy level, not just 1, or as many as we want? We do not yet know, so we don't know yet. But it is difficult to overestimate the impact of the discovery itself. The fact that energy levels are distinct and different for each type of the atom, and even for different molecules when the atoms bind together, provide a way of identifying the constituent parts of the materials without touching them. Sure. Okay. When electrons jump about between the different energy levels, they emit or absorb a characteristic amount of energy as photons of light. The science of the measuring and identifying these is called spectroscopy, and it is the reason we know what the sun, the other stars, and the dust between them are made of. Because only a certain discontinuous energy level are allowed, only certain jumps in energy are allowed, so only certain energy of the photon can be observed or emitted, and these show up either as dark lines in the spectrum of the light passing through the material where those wavelengths of the photon have been absorbed, or as a bright line in the light given off by the material when it is heated, such as a characteristic yellow line in a sodium lamp. The exact yellow, when measured precisely in the spectrometer, is enough to identify sodium as the main component of one of those lamps. Yes. Similarly, the line in the spectrum from the other materials allow us to see what kind of atoms are present. This explains the distinctive frequencies of the light, responsible for the discovery of the helium in the sun, for example. The electronic structure of atom and molecules, the detailed geography of the atom land, was discovered at energy scale of the few hundred or thousand electron volts. Electron volts, EV, is the energy of the motion that electrons acquire if it is accelerated one volt of the electric potential. So a 12 volt battery can accelerate an electron to an energy of 12 electron volt. To get to millions of the electron volt would require several hundred thousand of such batteries, or the nuclear power of one decaying nucleus. It was crucial in establishing the quantum nature of the electrons and photons, as well as telling us what elements are present in the stars and dust of the distant galaxies.
Sure.
It provides much inspiration and information for further exploration. The theory of how electrons and photons interact, QED, was the first part of the standard model of the particle physics to be developed, and the precision atomic physics measurements played a critical role in that development, as we will see as we voyage onwards. Atom land and quantum theory we picked up along the way is the point of the departure for the far reaches of the particle physics. The next step of the journey takes us back once more towards the island on which we first landed, the island containing Port Electron. For as we reach the south of Atom Land, we discover there is a bridge as well as a car rental shop. We cross the bridge, hire a car, and head off by a road to explore the new territory in the hinterland of the Port Electron.
Thank you.